evening and welcome to For the Record. Over the course of this show, we've done many programs on health awareness, specifically non-communicable diseases, and how we should be making the right choices, the right lifestyle choices, and eating healthy to avoid contracting any of these non-communicable diseases. It has been long said that NCDs are a major, major problem in Fiji, the leading cause of death at every age level, from middle aged right up to the elderly. And now we are seeing a trend where people in their 20s are contracting non-communicable diseases. There are various efforts underway by the government, by the health ministry, a number of NGOs working within the communities to try and get people to make the right decisions. One such NGO is Friend Fiji, and they have a novel way, a new sort of scheme to try and get people to realize the dangers of NCDs and how they can live a healthier life. And leading that charge is none other than Dr. Chone Hawea. Dr. Chone Hawea, an associate director with Friend Fiji, and he is joining us tonight in studio to talk about the programs that Friend is running and how it is proving beneficial and effective across all communities in Fiji. Dr. Chone, thank you very much for being on the show.
Thank you.
Welcome to For the Record. Let's start off with what the problem really is. NCDs, more specifically your area of work, diabetes and amputations. An amputation carried out every 12 hours.
One every 12 hours
for a population of less than 1 million. So how much of a problem is that really? And do we as a people realize this problem?
Well, I'll just try and put things into context. Our wards are full of these problems. And it's the most common cause of admission in our surgical wards. It's using up a lot of operation theater resources. It's the most, our theater list is full of diabetic amputations. It's the most common cause of death in our wards. It's the most common cause of long admission days. And those add up into costs. Now that's still at the hospital level. Then when you have amputations coming out of the hospital, they go into communities, they go into their families, and they become helpless. They can't do anything. There's not many rehabilitative structures in our community. You know, people do not get access to prosthesis, and they are not able to do normal work. They become a burden to their families. Added costs. Now that's on top of the medication costs that they have, and when they become a burden on the family, they become a burden on the community. They become a burden on the society at large. And so, when you have costs at the community level, you have costs at the healthcare level. When you put it all together, it's just a huge cost to this country. And when you look at the fact that the age group is getting younger. I have amputated people of 28, 29 year old, 30. Now we are looking at a major disabled population in the not so near future. So productivity for this nation is going to be really affected.
When we talk about amputation, that's in a way a sort of last ditch effort. But there is a process leading up to that, wherein the individual, the person, has room to act. And what happens within this time frame? How does a person know that, you know, they have problems?
At the moment, well, from my experience, we realized that most of our patients did not know that they had diabetes until the day they turned up at hospital. So awareness of having diabetes, then when people have diabetes, the awareness of how does the diabetic foot infection starts. And when you have an infection, how do they get from there to the healthcare facility to the hospital. And so there are a lot of gaps in between in preventing, getting to have diabetes. and getting to have a diabetic foot, which is a foot infection, which is a complication of that diabetes, and then getting the service, you know, quality service to reduce the amputation level, sort of, and then the rehabilitation, completion of the rehabilitation process. So each and every stage has a lot of gaps.
Your research and medicine has established that stress is also a contributing factor to this. We'll get to that later in the show, but the most basic cause that we know of and we speak about are our lifestyle choices, our eating choices. We are brought up in that way, aren't we? When children are born, they are given sweets, cakes, what have you. And if you grow up with that and you've lived with it for 20 years, 25 years, it's become a part of you. How difficult is it to get out of that change?
Yes, that's the most challenging part, because we are calling it lifestyle diseases. But what does it actually mean? It means that while I'm living my life, I'm developing these conditions. And so it's a big challenge to ask for people to change the way they are living their life. And the one thing I must say is life is more than just eating healthy and physical exercise. There's a lot of things that we get involved in, whether it's at home, at school, at church, and things like that. And in all of those things that we do in our life, the way we handle ourselves can determine whether we are going to go down the NCD route.
So if somebody in their 20s is sitting at home and they have been living this way, what are the chances of them? Is it 100%, 90%, 50%? What are the chances of them developing diabetes if they don't change their eating habits? Do you really need to be at an extreme, taking fizzy drinks, eating junk food every day, fatty foods, oily foods? Does it have to be at an extreme, or is it the daily diet, what you may think is a normal meal?
It's more of the everyday stuff that you do over a long time. And that's why it's a disease of chronic lifestyle choices. It's not just a matter of eating, you know, one load of junk today and I sort of will just go into diabetes or hypertension. It doesn't work that way. It's the things that you collectively do every day, and it has become a habit, and it has become me.
All right. On that note, we'll take a break. When we come back, we'll take a look at what we can do to fight diabetes and to live a healthy lifestyle. Stay with us. Well, Unaka, welcome back to For the Record. We're talking about diabetes and amputations in Fiji. Our guest is Dr. Chone Hawea, an associate director of the NGO Friend. Dr. Chone, we've been talking about lifestyle choices and how people are contributing to the problem itself. But you mentioned stress is something that also adds to this problem, and people may not be aware that they're going through it. How does that come into the picture?
A lot of people are not aware of the fact that stress is the number one starting point in all of this. As clinicians, especially surgeons, we never like to identify stress as the starting point, because we stress is something we can't do anything about as surgeons. But the evidence is there now. Evidence is there that stress is the starting point. And stress means the stresses of the mind, because everything starts with the mind. The body just follows what the mind says. If the mind is tuned to a stress situation, which means a fight or flight, the hormones that the body releases is responding to that stress, fight or flight situation, and all the other functions in the body are shut down to take care of that stressful situation. Now we are in this day and age, stress is now a lifestyle. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a lifestyle. We are stressed at home, we are stressed at work, we are stressed in school, we are stressed everywhere. Now imagine what the body is going through every day. It takes a beating. And basically, a lot of important functions that are supposed to be balancing things out get shut down so that the stress system can work.
Carry on.
And what happens is a buildup of a hormone that cortisol, actually. And this hormone actually starts a whole lot of processes in the body that takes a few organs into overuse, you know, and exhaustion. And when they go into exhaustion, it doesn't react to normal balancing situations. And so we are ending up with uncontrolled hypertension, uncontrolled diabetes, uncontrolled many other things, in uncontrolled inflammation. And then you have diseases of the joints, diseases of the muscles, diseases. Because everything is uncontrolled. The control mechanisms in the body have been shut down. And a few hormones are only at play.
And that would, for an average person like myself, how do I identify that I am in a stressful situation? Because if it's in the mind, we may not be able to register it as stress.
Yeah, sure. A lot of studies have proven that emotional stress is the number one decider of this hormone, whether it gets that elevated or this elevated. And then on top of that, you have the other, you know, the mental stresses from work commitments, school commitments. But emotional stress is one of the biggest contributors to this. And people do not recover well from emotional stress, especially from relationship situations, whether it's relationship in the family or relationship as partners, you know, marriage relationships, girlfriend-boyfriend relationships, friends relationship. And these are the situations that have been found out to contribute to an excess in cortisol, and the body goes through exhaustion, mental exhaustion from these.
And so it's an attack from two fronts, so to speak.
Yes.
One is the food we eat, which is a conscious decision,
yes.
and the stresses we go through, which we may not realize.
Yes. So the starting point actually is to manage the stress, because food and physical activity are supporting mechanisms. You get your balancing act right by managing your stress, then the food will make sense. You see, a lot of people don't realize this. They think, and if you think back, when I am stressed, even a nice dish in front of me, I do not have the appetite for it. And a lot of people think it's a conscious decision. Actually, they are not aware of the fact that the digestive hormones necessary to eat the many nutrients that are on the plate are not released by the body. And so, because it is a stress situation, it's a fight or flight, it's very energy demanding. And so the body will just need energy food. That's why when people are stressed, they go for high energy food like fatty foods, chocolates, and those kind of foods. And also, the other hormone is aldosterone, which is a hormone that makes sure that salt is retained in the body. And so that's why if for those who are listening out tonight, you will think back and you will see when you are stressed, you either go for high energy foods like chocolate, high fat food, ice cream, and those kind of things, or high salt, you know, chips and things like that. And it's not a conscious decision that they are making. It's both, actually, but the hormones are
it's explained. Influenced.
Yes.
It's influenced. So the stress is leading people to
to making the to to make those kind of choices, unhealthy choices, and emotional. And then you have the unhealthy behaviors of alcohol and drugs and those other things.
We've spoken for years about the problem of NCDs, yeah, and how people are not making the right lifestyle choices. But we've rarely, if at all, ever heard about how stress is an influencing factor, how it is silently contributing to, yes, this. I mean, it's a bit perplexing why this isn't out there as much as the message of eating right.
Yes.
From medical perspective, you understand this. You have studied it, and doctors know it. Yes. But everyday Fijians may not.
Specialization has influenced this a lot. So psychologists and psychiatrists are staying in their compartment. Surgeons in our compartment, other public health doctors are in compartment. And there's no linking. And so these people are saying stress. Psychologists and psychiatrists have been saying this for the past few decades. And they have been making a lot of movements in trying to advocate for stress management. You will find in our hospitals in Fiji there are stress management wards. But, you know, to break it down to a level where people understand what exactly is this stress and how can I manage it using everyday tools that I'm familiar with, so I can manage my stress so that what I eat and how I do my physical activity can then make sense and help me get towards a balanced state.
And that in itself wouldn't be easy if you have one person coming through every 12 hours for an amputation. We're talking about bringing all these various arms of the medical service. That in itself is a challenge.
Yes. You know, when people come in for an amputation, we are at the bottom of a cliff. And people are jumping and they are shattered into pieces. And all we are doing is trying to make sense of the pieces and to create a picture of a human being. You know, it's not a good way of saying it, but that's what we are doing as surgeons doing amputations. We are at the bottom of a cliff. And so there are a lot of gaps before people present to our wards, to our surgical wards for an amputation. There are a lot of things that can be done. And because it's a lifestyle issue and it involves everybody, I think almost everyone in Fiji by now has a relative who has been affected by this condition. And so everyone has a role to play in this.
Okay. And with that, we've come to the end of another segment. Stay with us. We'll be back shortly. Welcome back to For the Record. Our discussions tonight, amputations, diabetes, and the work that FRIEND is doing in the communities. Our guest is Dr. Chone Hawea, an associate director of FRIEND. Doc, since joining FRIEND, you've sort of been leading the charge on a new way to approach NCDs, to approach diabetes, and try and reduce amputations. Of course, there have been a number of awareness programs. The health ministry is doing its own. Yes. But you've sort of redefined how to get the message across. What exactly are you doing with FRIEND?
What attracted me to FRIEND and in the first place, because FRIEND has been doing this for quite a while, what attracted me is the integrated approach that FRIEND had, because FRIEND is about economic empowerment. And then it takes out a social empowerment because people need to have money to take them out of poverty. But then they need to be socially empowered to do these decision makings. It takes a lot to even take a first step. Now, with those two methodologies, it made sense that FRIEND was taking out a health part to it because people prioritize money. You know, there is a health problem, yes. But people need money to do these things. They need to go to the hospital. They need to pay for medications. They need to pay their bus fare or taxi fare. And sometimes they need to even pay for medications and repeated doses. So it's a health problem that has a lot of other associated, you know, societal issues, everyday issues. And so the methodology with FRIEND is being creative about how we even take out the language of NCDs. We are not talking to subjects that like to read books and deal with jargon, medical jargon. And so FRIEND has simplified a lot of you know, definitions of these conditions to speak in a language that they understand and be able to do simple steps by themselves. And that's health promotion. It's about empowering the people to take on and decide their own fate, whether it's economic empowerment, social empowerment, or health empowerment. Hmm. And so that's why we have programs like backyard gardening that's run by the community members, trying to improve on the number of vegetables and root crops that are available so that they have easy access, and just educating people a little bit on the fact that, you know, herbs also can be part of the backyard garden. And if they have 5 or 6 different kind of vegetables or herbs, then you have many nutrients that's just at the doorstep. And if you have many other root crops, then, you know, the same thing applies. And then we are trying to take out, with our economic empowerment, we deal with budgeting. You know, financial health is also a health promotion activity. You know, a lot of people who are in financial crisis or debt, they have hypertension, and there's an increasing number of cardiac problems and diabetes and hypertension amongst people with financial problems. It's well documented as evidence, and so that's how a FRIEND deals with it. Because when we go out into the community, we find that 60 to 70% of the home budget is just on food. And so if people plan their own food, first of all, they have healthier choices to cook, and they are able to save and use their money to you know, do projects for their families, for their communities. And so that's the creative way we are doing it. The other thing is about doing awareness in a language that makes the community able to digest information well, that makes sense. Because medical language is very hard to understand for a common person. And a lot of us as health professionals, we like to do these health promotion programs. Yes, we've done it. We've done our job. We've said this and said this. But how much does the average person understood and be able to do something about that information?
How hard is it to get people to change?
Behavior change is a difficult thing to, it's a challenge to be able to impact people's behavior. But the one thing that impacts a lot on people's behavior is the way you communicate the information across. If you are speaking in a different language, and in Fiji, we know Fijians. You know, Fijians have our own way of communication, and the language we use. For a long time, we have been doing this. You know, don't do this, don't do this. The reverse psychology usually happens. When you tell people what to do, they will do exactly the opposite. So the language has been changing, and I'm really happy that the Ministry of Health has changed its tone a little bit in saying, you know, this causes this causes this. Make the right choice.
You did a public talk recently, and you began by saying that diabetic patients who come into the hospitals who have foot problems, their feet, their sores smell like septic tanks. Those are the words you used. Is that the kind of message that we need to be sending out? And is that how you reach out to these communities,
yes,
speaking frankly and openly?
Yes. In the Western context, it's seen as unethical. In our Pacific context, we have to drum in the fact this is a problem. It's a septic tank. The organisms actually that survive in a septic tank where there's no oxygen are the same organisms that are living in those tissues, because they are dying tissues. The oxygen is not reaching because of diabetes, and the blood flow has been affected. And so those are, I have shown amputation photos, of course. I cover the faces and things like that. But you have to, it's a crisis. You have to do the extreme to be able to have at least a small behavior change. And pamphlets and posters have not worked, you know. So communication, you have to speak in a language that will make people realize this is a problem. We are saying obesity is a problem, but in our Pacific context and in Fiji, being big can be seen also as being healthy. And if people are not seeing obesity as a problem, why do you have to use a lot of resources in trying to educate on something that people just don't get? But when you
because of our cultural
because of our social cultural context.
Of course, we have to take a break now. We'll carry on discussions in a bit. But for now, we're going for a quick break. We'll be right back. Good evening. Welcome back to For the Record. We are in discussions with Dr. Johnny Hawea, the Associate Director of FRIEND and specializing in reducing NCDs, reducing non-communicable diseases and diabetes. We were just talking about how obesity isn't seen as being unhealthy. Of course, Pacific culture and social settings. But I mean, from when a child is able to eat solids, they are not kept on a healthy diet. Mm. And that becomes part of life.
Yes.
How do you change that?
Well, that's why the health promotion activities that are happening are starting from early motherhood, from early stages of pregnancy up until the elderly. So everyone is to be covered, because even the diet that the mother takes during pregnancy affects the taste of the unborn child. By the time the child is born, they have a new set of tastes that they have been exposed to. And so health promotion starts from gestation and it ends at the elderly age. And so with children, we see in our families, you know, when we visit relatives, we take Bongo and Twisties and all those junk food. You know, no more are people taking fruits, bananas and mangoes and, you know, popo, things that are healthy. Now, the children are learning from that. So they see a good occasion as and it's associated with this junk food. So good occasion, junk food. And fruits, nobody deals with fruits. And so everyone has a role to play, even when we are just doing our visiting family and friends and functions. When we are having our functions, our church functions, our religious functions, our community functions. I have been discussing with a lot of pastors, and they have shared how it is very difficult to refuse junk food, because it's been prepared by, you know, a congregation that want to you know, do well for the pastor. But I am really impressed with how the Seventh-day Adventists have done theirs. They have made it a policy in all their church functions that there is only healthy food and no junk food. So
what sort of junk food cooked at home? I mean, people would think junk food,
well,
yes, you buy it at the supermarket.
You know, probably junk, the word junk really doesn't augur well.
People may not realize it,
yes.
but it is really. What
so
sort
highly
of
highly sweetened food and drinks. Because a lot of our functions have cakes and pies and different forms of cakes and pies. And it's a high sugar load for everyone. And we are having functions after functions after functions, week in, week out, whether it's community or church or religious gatherings. And we are having an increase of oily fried foods across all ethnic groups in Fiji. So you have oily fried, and then you have tea that's highly sugared, and you know, and then you have the cakes and the pies, and this goes on and on every week, week in, week out. So the onus is on the leaders of these organizations, the communities, the you know, the churches, the religious groups, to be able to make the stand and say we should put in these policies. In the comfort of your own homes, you are free to decide what you want to eat. But when you organize functions that encompasses the whole community, you know, we are exposing everybody to unhealthy food.
There is a social responsibility.
Yes, there is a social responsibility to do some, the right thing. Yeah?
Behavioral change is difficult, of course. It's about making that personal choice. But actually, when you decide to make that choice, when you decide to change your eating habits and whatnot, is it hard to obtain these foods? Is it more expensive to go healthy? Is it time consuming to find these food items, or is it the opposite?
It really depends on where we are. In the rural communities of Rai and Naita Siri, you have access to these every day. But where the majority of Fiji's population is, like the Suvarnosori and Lami corridor, access to healthy food, affordability is also another issue. But mainly it's access. So it's good that we are promoting, we are saying, okay, don't eat this, don't eat this, don't eat this. But if I don't eat this, what is the alternative? And is the alternative available? Is the alternative affordable? And so those are issues that touch into policies and creating healthy choices, vending places, so that people have easy access to healthy food. In the supermarkets, you know, the unhealthy foods are readily available at eye level. And
brightly displayed.
Yes, brightly displayed, and very good marketing tactics have really worked. Whereas we are trying to shout healthy choice, but the alternatives are not available. And when they are available, they are coming in at high prices. And there's a lot of regulation factors to these. And so the policymakers have a big role to play in ensuring that healthy choices are available and accessible and affordable.
Okay, and we've come to the end of another segment. We'll be back after this short break. Pulunaka, welcome back to the show. We're about to wrap up for the evening, but Dr. Chone Hawea is still with us. We're talking about diabetes and amputations and how much of a problem it is in Fiji. Doc, based on the work that you've been doing with Friend and your experiences in the public health sector, over 1,000 amputations that you've done personally, if nothing changes, if people continue to lead the lifestyles that they do, what sort of problem are we looking at in, say, 10 years or 20 years? Or let's say in the next 5 years even.
In the next 5 years, Edwin, we are looking at a disabled population. Very unproductive. We do not have the rehabilitative environment to cater for disability. When people come out of our operating theater and they go back into their families, nobody supports them. They lose their jobs. Sometimes their family breaks up. And so people take a dive into depression. And when you have young people like 28, 29, 30-year-olds going into that, you can imagine the potential costs, you know, the potential income, productivity that is already lost if we don't do anything.
What changes have you seen? I understand it's been a short time frame, but the work that you've been doing at community level, have there been quick turnovers? What sort of changes have you identified?
We are finding a lot of, there's been a lot of good feedback, especially from community leaders. They are, you know, making healthier choices. They are making policies at the family level, at the family gathering, at the village gathering. They are, when they do functions, they are making sure that a lot of healthy food is available, and they are doing a lot of planting. So there's been a lot of movement. I also did a cooking show with Robert Oliver, and I had a lot of very positive feedbacks from the institutions, the discipline forces institutions, that they have you know, followed some of the recipes, like the juices, the fresh fruit juices, the mango lassi, and those things, and so behavior has been impacted. It's you know, you really have to go back and do an analysis of how much impact it is making. But the feedback that we are getting,
there
is very
anecdotal evidence, at least. And just finally, very quickly, would you say that people in the urban and peri-urban areas are at higher risk of getting diabetes and going for amputations, or is it a national problem? Is it that people in rural communities are able to plant and are able to till the land and have gardens, healthy food choices?
It's a national problem. At the end of the day, everyone will get affected by it, because when health budgets are going towards diabetes, other health problems will be neglected. It will come down to that. And so some of the services that should reach our rural areas will definitely be affected. But you are right, the peri-urban and the urban population are the ones at highest risk, because of accessibility and affordability and the stress levels that's happening, the commitments that people are having in these urban areas.
Dr. Chone, that brings us to the end of the show. Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you very much, Edwin.
And that wraps up our show for this evening. If you have any interest in the program that is run by Friend, you can definitely get in touch with them. They are listed in the directory, and I'm sure Dr. Chone would be more than willing to come into your community and run some of these programs. But for tonight, that is the end of For the Record. If you have any comments or questions, you can email us fortherecord@fbc.com.fj. Up next is Nemani Ndela Mbatiki with his weekly column, My Say. From me for tonight, good evening. I'll see you next Sunday.